Ladies and gentlemen, if country constitutions were a perfect reflection of the current state of society, and if constitutional courts were accurately and independently representing the views of the people in an independent and accountable fashion, we wouldn't have the problems that we have today. Where constitutional courts involve political appointments, where they routinely block legislation, and where they enforce a constitution which doesn't reflect the society that we have today. That's the problem that we're trying to address at Opening Government. And what we're proposing is that rather than have the current state where the constitutional or supreme courts can strike down legislation and go against an elected government trying to push through an agenda, what we say on the outside of the house is if that constitutional court deems that it is likely or probably unconstitutional, what we say is that that court should be able to call a referendum, that referendum should be able to go to the people, and if the people by a two-thirds majority deem that that legislation should pass, then it will pass. If they don't, it won't. We say that that model of actually having the constitution, still having those courts, but having them as a check and balance by going through direct democratic procedures is a far better model than what we currently have, where we have 7 or 9 political appointments to stop legislation from being passed in that fashion. That's what we're proposing, that's what we're defending on Open Government. What do we think will happen when we introduce this model? We say that for starters, there's likely to be far fewer court challenges because there's focus less on sort of the legal intricacies of an argument and whether or not it is consistent with a document that was written 2 centuries ago, but rather actually looking at whether it reflects the will of the people and actually trying to educate the people through normal, everyday language that they can understand rather than through legal challenges. Sure.
Sorry, I missed it. Is it that 2/3 of the people have to vote to declare something to be unconstitutional or to declare it to be constitutional?
So let's be clear on this. If the court says that it's likely to be unconstitutional, that is if they're likely to block it, then instead of blocking it, we say it goes to the people. And then if the people by 2/3 majority want to block it, that's fine. If they don't, they won't. Hopefully that clarifies it. And I'm going to explain why that mechanism and why that direction is hugely important. What I'm going to bring you up, Prime Minister, is 4 key things. Why the Constitutional Court at the moment is not independent, not accountable, and not representative. That's my first point. Second point, why under our model that leads to more democratic representation. Third, why a model like this of direct democracy is far superior as a model. And fourthly, why constitutions do not reflect the current state of society and why this provides them with an avenue to better fulfill the functions that actually had them in the first place. No, thank you. So firstly, why these courts do not actually fulfill their roles. Because what we say is that these people, for starters, are certainly not independent. They're not objective players. Why? Because in both the US and in countries like Australia, it's the government who has political leadings who actually undertakes these appointments. We see it in Australia, where you actually need to come out and almost say what stance you are, which policy or political party you align with, in order to increase your chances of being actually selected for this court. We also see this in the US, where there are clear political appointments time and time again. And so what this means is that when you have people, in order to be elected, needing to say that they have particular views on abortion, or particular views on immigration, or particular views on interpretations of the Constitution, it's quite clear which way they're going to rule in different cases. And because you have an odd number of people on these Supreme Courts, what we're always going to have, and what we've seen time and time again, is you have a majority, either Republican or Democratic supporters in that instance, and so they're likely to push through policies in a particular way. We say that that's not an objective assessment of the Constitution, nor an objective assessment of policies. We also see that it's not accountable, because what we see in this case is that when you don't have the normal checks and balances that you have on people with this much power. What we say is these people often are in that position for life. They can't be voted out. They can't be held accountable. So even if their decisions completely are not legally grounded, what we say is there's no avenue through which they can be removed in many jurisdictions under the status quo. We also say that they're just simply not reflective of modern-day society. What you have time and time again is old white men who are making decisions on the abortions that young women in society, often of ethnic minorities, might be undertaking. And we say that that lack of ethnic composition means that those views aren't representative, aren't accurate, and aren't skewed. And there's a reason why this is. That often to be elected to these positions, you need to have had a long career in the legal system. You need to have been educated 50 years ago when the education of these people was completely different in terms of the quantity of it. Next point about democratic representation. What we see is that if the court allows laws to pass, which we're fine with under our model, because we don't see a way around it, we see that that's sufficient because what we have is that that's a pass by an elected government. And we also say that the time frame in which to change that is much shorter. That if a public, if a population disagrees with a few, with a law that is passed, then it is only a few years before they have another say, where they can change that government through election, through campaigning, through lobbying, etc. So if laws are allowed to pass, we're fine with that, or at least it's less bad under our side. But if a policy is blocked by a court, you can have that same court in power for decades on end, or you can have political appointments with the same leads. What that means is that this court directly goes against the government that was elected, and you can't actually change the composition of that court. You can't change that decision until the composition of that court actually changes, which is a very long, drawn-out process, yes.
If 2/3 of the population will massively infringe on the rights of a minority, are you okay?
Right. Let's go on to this. I'll go on to the point about minorities in a second. But what we had is, like, in the 1930s, we had, like, US Supreme Court struck down, like, the New Deal, which clearly overstretched the government's power. And we think that under the status quo, what we have is situations where the court directly goes against the will of the majority of people and isn't reflective. We say that's less likely than under our side. But let's go on to this issue of, like, direct democracy and why that leads to greater protection of minorities. That's why we're requiring more than a simple majority. That's why we're requiring a 2/3. Because if there is a division within society, we think that's more likely to be protected under our side of the house than when we have a court with judges who might be of one ethnic group with certain political leaders. We say that our law does a better protection for minorities because in the same way that a majority of the population often doesn't want a minority oppressed, we say that you're unlikely to get greater than 70% of the population actually pushing for extreme radical policies that offset the minority groups. And we see this in like Switzerland, for example, where there's a lot of direct democracy in issues that are controversial. That hasn't changed. We also think there'll be far greater education of the people when you're not dealing with legal language. Last point, why the constitution needs to evolve. We say that in order to have social progress, we need to have a society that reflects the current state of that society. The document that was written 200-300 years ago isn't going to do that. We see that in the case of the Second Amendment, for example, where like the interpretation of rights and lines is very different today than what it is in the past. Ladies and gentlemen, because the current state doesn't provide protection that it needs, because it doesn't provide...